So good to see you. Thank you for tuning in. Well, the sermon title is today, it's Face Life Without Fear. Come on, now who knows that with all the politics that's going on at the moment, that I know I have been, these little thoughts come into my mind, what will the future look like? Who knows that with the reports about the economy and the uncertainty of that, all of a sudden you have these thoughts saying, you know, what is my future going to look like? Maybe some people are looking for a job or struggling to find a job, and then the thoughts about what's my future going to look like? And all of a sudden there can be fear in our life because of this uncertainty. But I want to say that you should never have an uncertainty in your future. Why? That you can face fear without any worry or fear at all. That your life is a good life that is ahead of you. And you know what? I felt to bring to this story in the book of Numbers chapter. It's going to start in Numbers chapter 13. But if you've got your Bibles, grab your Bibles to Numbers chapter 14. We're going to turn to there. This is actually the story of Moses, and he sent out 12 spies. God had promised Moses that he was going to give the children of Israel a land flowing with milk and honey. They were going to live in houses they didn't build. They were going to have things that they reap from vineyards that they didn't plant. And God had promised this to Moses. Now, Moses sent 12 spies out to spy out the land. And you'll find in Numbers chapter 13, and then it flows into Numbers chapter 14, that the spies came back and they saw this land. Oh, yes, it was good. But 10 of the spies came back with a negative report. And these 10 spies said, oh, the giants, they're too big. And the walls, the city walls, they're too fortified. There's no way we can take this land. But there was two men, Caleb and Joshua. And they said, no, God is able to give us this land. And so you know what? Whenever you're facing difficulties, the world will want you to look at your circumstances. And that's how fear works. The enemy works that very same way. When fear or difficulties come, that we seem to look with our natural eye and say, oh, I don't see how I can get a job. There's this reason, and this reason. Or maybe you might be looking and going, oh, I don't know how I can do this. I don't know how I can overcome this obstacle. I don't know how I can face this giant on my own. But God wants you to see things with spiritual eyes. So we're going to turn to Numbers chapter 14, verse 6. It says here, we're going to pick up the story from here. It says, but Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes. So here we are here. The 10 spies were given this negative report. These two were so upset. They ripped off their shirts. They tore their clothes. They were so upset because of this negative report that was coming back to the children of Israel. And the words that Caleb and Joshua said are so powerful. And that's what my sermon is to today, that you don't have to face life with fear, that you have a confident expectation of good in your life. So Caleb and Joshua, they tore their clothes and they spoke to the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, the land we pass through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. Yeah. Now, I'm going to stop right there for just a moment, because one thing, when I looked through the book of Numbers, I could not find Caleb and Joshua denying that there was problems. They never said, giants? What giants? It's like the RACQ ad, charter boat? What charter boat? They never said, giants? No. No, there's no such thing as giants. They never said the city walls weren't strong and weren't great. But what they declared is that God is stronger. You know, I think that's a little seed of advice for a lot of people. You know what? When we're going through a hard time, how easy is it for us to be looking at the situations and then we start confessing, oh yeah, I'm never going to get a job in this economy. Or then we look at things and go, oh, money coming out, never coming in. And then we look at other circumstances and we say, oh, there's other people getting sick. There's other people and their businesses are closing. And it's so easy that we can get into this rut of speaking out what we see in front of us. But what Caleb and Joshua started to speak is it is an exceedingly good land. And for us, we need to start confessing God is an exceedingly good God, and that God is well able to provide for us. God is well able to restore. God is well able to heal. Sometimes we look at the situation, we look at the circumstance and say, oh, there's people dying from that sickness. Oh, I've never seen this person get healed from this before. And we can get stuck in that rut, but God wants us to confess that it is an exceedingly good land, that God can heal, and that God can provide, restore, and rescue you. And then we pick it up here in verse 8, and this is what Caleb and Joshua said. I think it's powerful. They said this: if the Lord delights in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us. Now, I want to have a look at this, because they didn't say, if the Lord delights in us. They were speaking to the congregation of Israel, and they were saying, if the Lord delights in us, he's going to bring us. One thing Caleb and Joshua knew is that, point number one, is that the Lord delighted in them. I want to tell you that you have a different spirit about you. My whole sermon is about that there is a different outlook for you, the children of God, as to the outlook for the people of the world. Why? God delights in you. Psalms chapter 18, verse 19. He led me to a place of safety. He rescued me because he delights in me. I want to say that God delights in you. The Bible says in Zephaniah that he rejoices over you with singing. The Bible talks about of all the grains in the sand of the sea, that all those granules, if you go to the beach and you picked up the sand and you grab some of the little granules and you just put it in your little finger and you see all the different granules. And the Bible says that his thoughts toward you outnumber the granules of sand in the sea. Have you ever done that, gone to the beach and just had a look at all the granules and just all those granules just in your little fingertip, and then you look at the entire beach? Can I encourage you that the Lord delights in you? No matter what economic situation we're going to land ourselves in, no matter who is the president, no matter what happens in our future, God delights in you. And God's going to look after you despite what you may see. The truth is, my God delights in me. And my God is for me. And he will look after me. Even if I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? For he is with me. And one thing Caleb and Joshua knew is that God delights in them. And they're convincing the children of Israel, hey, God delights in you. They weren't saying, if the Lord, well, let's just hope. No, they knew that God delighted it, that God was for them. Yes, it would have been scary to look at the giants of Anak, to look at the fortified city walls, to think, how on earth can we take this city? How on earth can this land be ours? But one thing Caleb and Joshua knew is that the Lord delighted in them. Amen. Come on, let's continue to read. He said, if the Lord delights in us, he will bring us to this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people of the land, for they are our bread. Just think about this phrase, for they are our bread. You know what? In the chapter just earlier, in chapter 13, the report from the spies came back to the children of Israel and they said, oh, these giants are so big. We were like grasshoppers in their sight. That's what the children of Israel said. We were like just these tiny grasshoppers in the sight of these giants. Just think about this. Did they go and interview a giant? And did they ever say, how do you see us? No, they didn't. Why? It was the fear that let them dominate their life. And whenever you let fear dominate your life, you will see yourself small. You will see God small. But instead, we need to say, hey, this is our bread. What do I mean by that? Bread is something that you eat and something that you devour. You know what? When problems are ahead in your life, that if God allows these problems to face, it's because God is launching you to a higher level. That God will allow these problems because it will strengthen you. Why does it say in Romans 5 verse 3 that we can glory in tribulation? I don't like preaching on that. But the truth is that we can rejoice when problems come. Why? Because this is our bread. Bread is designed to get you stronger and make you grow. You know, through the difficulties and through the testings and through the trials, this is our bread. This situation that I'm going through is going to cause me to grow. It's going to cause me to get stronger. And it's going to cause me to go to a new level. God does not allow problems and situations to come and destroy you. He's not there punishing you going, see, you couldn't overcome that last obstacle. I'm going to give you one to just top you off the edge. No, that's not how God works. God will say, yes, here's a problem, but I know greater is he that's in within you than he that's in the world. And I'm going to use this to cause you to get stronger. I'm going to use this situation to cause you to go higher. You know why? This is bread for us. Can I encourage you? Next time you are going through a difficulty, maybe you're facing a trial or a difficult time, start to declare, this is bread for me. That what the devil has meant for harm, God, you will use it for good. One thing Joshua and Caleb knew is that the Lord delighted in them. And that although this temporary problem, this was put in front of them to show of the greatness of God, to show that they can, the children of Israel, can overcome, that the promised land is theirs. And I believe there are so many people here. God has got promises for you. And it's by faith that we receive it. And yes, you will come into obstacles. Yes, you'll come into difficult situations. Yes, you might see the craziness of what's going on in politics. You might see the economy or whatever's going on. But I want you to know that God delights in you and that this is used to launch you further. This is our bread. Amen. Come on, for they are our bread and their protection. Listen to this. Listen to the confidence that Joshua and Caleb had. He says this, their protection has departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear. You know what they knew? They knew that God, your protection is with us. Even though it's fearful. Hey, I'm being honest. I was looking at some of the election results and what's going on in America, and then I get this little thought, what if China attacks Australia? Then I get this thought, would America even help and protect Australia? They've never done in the past. And then all of a sudden I catch myself finding, goodness me, fear starts to creep in. You go, oh, what would life look like? Hang on. One thing I need to look much further than any country is that Jesus will protect me. Despite the feelings, I don't walk by feelings. I walk by faith and not by sight. And I know, just like Caleb and Joshua, that my God will protect me. And he'll protect my family. And he'll protect you no matter what the world may tell you, no matter what the media may say. God will protect you. Why? God's with you. They were saying, hey, God's not with them. God is with us. Come on, how many times do you say, God, you're with me. God, you're protecting me. Why? There was something different about Joshua and Caleb to the rest of the children of Israel. And when you look through the rest of the verses, I can't read it for the sake of time, but when you read the rest of the verses, then God starts to speak and God says, because you didn't believe that this generation's not going to enter the promised land, except there were two people that outlived that generation, Caleb and Joshua, and they took the promised land. Let's have a look at what the Lord says in verse 23. They certainly shall not see the land which I swore to their fathers, nor shall any of those who rejected me see it. Whew, heavy stuff. Verse 24 says, though, but my servant Caleb, because he has a different spirit. Come on, I'm speaking to you here. Victory Church, you have a different spirit. Come on, when difficulties and trials and pressures come, you have a, let's all say it, a different spirit. This is powerful. Because this different spirit causes you to face life without fear. Why? You've got a different spirit. The world may say, oh, but listen to the doctor's report. The world may say, yeah, but look at the economy. The world may say this and that, but you have a different spirit. If you get nothing out of today's sermon, understand this truth, that you have a different spirit. Come on, I looked up this in the Bible. This is the word that I got as I was reading, and I was like, a different spirit? And something leapt up on the inside. I knew God wanted to talk to our church about this truth, that you do have a different spirit like Caleb. And so I looked up where the Word of God says the spirit that He's given us. You know what? God said He's given us a spirit of adoption. It says this in Romans chapter 8, verse 15. It says this, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage against to fear, but you received what? A spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. This spirit that you've received, this different spirit, is a spirit of adoption, where now you belong to the family of God. And just like me as a natural parent, because Holly and Harry are part of my family, they will always be protected by me. And because you've been adopted into God's family, God will always protect you. Why? You're part of His family. Because now you have a different spirit, a spirit of adoption, you'll always know that God will always provide for you. That's that different spirit that God gives us. You've not received that spirit to fear. No matter what you see, that's not the spirit that you've been given. You have a different spirit that says, no, I've been adopted into the family of the Lord. You know what else? The Bible talks about that you've been given a different spirit, a spirit of faith. Come on, that means no matter what you walk through, you don't walk by sight, that you walk by faith. It's a different spirit that God has breathed into you. It says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke. We also believe and therefore we speak. Because you have a different spirit, you now have a spirit where you speak and things change. The Bible says that life and death are in the power of the tongue. But because you have a different spirit, the Word of God is what you speak. The Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, as it says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. The Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. So when you speak, thus it is written, God, you will provide for me. That's now the position that you are in. Oh, I hope God provides for me. No, you have a different spirit. You have a spirit which quotes the Word of God and the power of the Word of God. You know what? In Hebrews chapter 4, where it says that the Word of God is living, powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword. The word two-edged, in fact, is the Greek, which means two mouths. Isn't that interesting? Why? Because God spoke it, and now we, in our position, speak what He's spoken. And that's what's living, and that's what's powerful, and that's what's sharp. Oh, there might be fears. I'm not saying that what you're going through is not important. I'm not saying that it's not difficult. But you have a different spirit where you say, no, I speak the Word of God over this situation. By His stripes, they are healed. Come on, why? You have a what? A different spirit. You've been given a spirit of adoption. you've also been given the spirit of faith. God's given us the spirit of his son. Galatians chapter 4 verse 6, it says, because you are sons, God sent forth the spirit of his son into your heart. Wow. God has given me a different spirit, the spirit of his son into my heart, crying out, Abba Father. Therefore, because I've got a different spirit, therefore, because I have the spirit of God's son living inside of me, therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ Jesus. Come on, you are now in this position. You have a different spirit about you. No longer have you got to try and earn and work for this blessing of God. You are a son and a daughter of the Most High. What a different spirit you have about you. Now you can face life without the fear. Why? Because you have the spirit of God's son. You are an heir. You are no longer a slave where God will dismiss you, go, no. You are a son and a daughter of the Most High God. What a different spirit there is about you. Look, this is why Joshua and Caleb, they said, hey, the Lord delights in us. Why can they say that? Because they knew there was something different about the Lord. They had a heart. They knew God's heart. They knew that God delighted in them. Can I encourage you, those who know they've got a different spirit, know that you've received a spirit of adoption. Now you belong into the family of God. You're going to be protected. Can I encourage you, the same spirit that dwells in me, dwells in you. That's the same spirit of faith. And therefore, because I have received that spirit, I declare and I speak what the word of God is. That's the truth in my life. And I tell you what, there is power when that's released. And you've also received the spirit of his son. Church, can we all stand? You've received a different spirit. Come on, will you lift your hands to the Lord right now? Just as the music team come. Father, I thank you. In each and every person, there is a different spirit. No matter what they face, no matter what they're going through, God, I thank you that there is a different spirit. For all those people watching online, I thank you that, God, you've given them a different spirit. Bless them, Lord.